Our second course is on comparative religion. First, by way of introduction, I have written several books in comparative religion. This is the most comprehensive, covering all the major religions of the world. The reason for taking a course in comparative religion is that there is such widespread, what shall I call it, maneuvering to promote rival religions to both Christianity and Catholicism. After the Second World War, when some 50 new nations came into existence in Africa, Asia, most of these nations forbade Protestant missionaries to evangelize in their countries. Protestant missionary work is over 250 years old. And having taught in New York for 14 years, I came to know the leaders of the Association of, well, Christian religions in New York. They told me that with the Protestant missionaries being forbidden to continue evangelizing India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and several dozen countries in Africa, what they decided was to direct all their energy and their money, billions of dollars, in converting the Latin American Catholics to Protestantism. They have been phenomenally successful. Vatican's figures are at least 1 million Latin American Catholics become Protestants every year. That's one side. Then non-Christian religions like Islam, the most powerful religion in the world, powerful through its weaponry. Muhammad, the founder of Islam, I consider the greatest military leader of all times, superior to Caesar, superior to Napoleon. And what he did was to create a new religion called Islam, to be promoted by force of arms. And the most extensive and powerful Muslim city in America is, in case you don't know, Detroit. The impact has been gigantic. The New Age movement. I'm away from Calcutta. I spent several hours in London, said mass there, had a meal, and on my way back to the airport, I saw a big bookstore, but two walls covered And every one was a distinct book, several hundred books, all on the New Age. New Age is simply Hinduism and Buddhism imported to the Western world, penetrating the lives of millions of once professed and believing Catholics. However, it's not just my theory for protective reasons, but over the years, having taught my own Jesuits from all over the world, and they came in from all over the world, I was teaching them in the United States. They go back to the various countries, and I found out so many of them knew very little about the religions, Buddhism, Jainism, Islam, you name it. Going back as priests, well, to exercise the priesthood in these largely non-Christian countries. So I prayed, and it seemed obvious. I better understand these non-Christian religions. I'm going to prepare my Jesuits to go back to India, Tanzania, wherever they were going back to, and exercise their priestly ministry. So I spent years studying the non-Christian religions, and then decided, as the book you have illustrates, to write on the subject. I am guessing, but I would say at least 250,000 copies of this book have been printed and bought. Now, what I'd like to share with you is what I have in your opening chapter on comparative religion in perspective. I will just choose and pick. I have a larger printout for my... Oh. You don't have this, do you? You have it in your book, though. I'm sorry about it. Oh. Thank you. I didn't get a copy of the book, so... It's page 3 in your... Shall I call it a textbook? And the same thing, may I ask you? In our next class, to read, first of all, I told you to read the whole of the set of notes, the document of Second Vatican II on the priesthood. Secondly, would you please read this chapter on comparative religion in perspective. Our time is necessarily limited in the number of weeks we have to cover the class matter. I would like to just choose and pick a sentence here or a sentence there to give you some perspective as to why we are taking this course and its value. Never before were the more urgent reasons to learn about the religious faith and practices of other people. We are the universal instinct to know all we can about our fellow man in order to know ourselves. And I would say, as I've taught so many priests over the years, and even the Holy See in lecturing to missionaries for 6 winters on the visiting professorship, taught at the University of Ottawa, and taught, well, comparative religion two missionaries who came back to, in this case, Canada, to get a graduate degree, including a doctorate, if they wanted it, in the religions of the world. This is now almost 2,000 years since Christ came into the world. Some 6 billion people in the world today. At very most, 2 billion are even nominal Christians. Whether Catholics, Protestants, Orthodox, you name it. And most of the world is not even Christian in name. Some 900 million Muslims. If we're going to convert the world that Christ told his apostles, proclaim the gospel to all nations. And this is what the Holy See has been telling me. We must understand something about the religions of other people. Of course, you better know your own Catholic faith well. If we're going to, as we say, convert these people both to Christianity and, please God, to Catholic Christianity, we must know something about what they believe. Why? This may be a surprise to you. I would never have got into the science of comparative religion if I had not, over the years, learned that these non-Christian religions have a great deal of truth within them. Misguided, misdirected, misinterpreted, and of course, woefully inadequate. And consequently, and this is the mind of the Holy Father, when you convert people, say among the Protestants, to the Catholic faith, or among the non-Christians, to Christianity, the secret is to build on what we have in common. Let's go to the last paragraph of page 3. A rampant communism denies the existence of a personal God and all glories in its conquest. Almost a fourth of the world's population is part of the result of ignorance on both sides of the idealism of the East and West. And I hope I've said this before, the most powerful communist country in the world is the United States. Do you hear me? The most powerful communist nation in the world is the United States. I began reading Karl Marx, as I've said more than once, at the age of 14. Marxism has been adopted by so many of our leaders in America. And in Marxism, as we know, there is no faith in a personal God. And this is the main theme of Pope John Paul II in his, as I mentioned earlier, Splendor of the Truth. O nations, says the Holy Father, have become pagan. Where their norm of morality is what? Their own mind and their own will, which is, having taught graduate courses in Marxism over the years, a good simple definition of Marxism. Let me go on. Bottom of the next page 4, a graphic example of ineptitude in handling a grief problem is the current one of offering contraception as the best, if not unique, solution to the so-called population explosion. Many of the world's peoples resent America's promotion of contraceptives because it violates their spiritual natures. Burma, for example, is 85% Hinayana Buddhist, with high ideals of self-sacrificing charity. His leaders are brutally frank in exposing what they consider self-interest disguised as philanthropy. American politicians, the Burmese are told in a Rangoon publication called The Nation, are obsessed with this thing that somebody has called Asia's population explosion, unquote. We can say is that if the dispensing of our birth control information is a limit of American ingenuity, inventiveness, and technical know-how, they are welcome to use all of it themselves. One nation after another, and America is controlling billions in population and billions in finances. And as you may remember, when the United Nations meeting in Beijing, there was to be a massive opposition, precisely opposition to the overpopulation of, well, countries in Asia and Africa. Guess whom, maybe you know, Pope John Paul II got to side with the Catholic Church and Beijing. Guess whom? The Muslims. Thank God. Let me continue. 50 years ago, it would have been naive to talk seriously about a dialogue between Christianity and the non-Christian religions of the world. But how much has happened since the middle of the present century? Third full paragraph on page 5. Any response that Christians make to the non-Christian world must be predicated on the assumption that a new situation has arisen, which demands intelligent appraisal and reaction. What is this new encounter with the great religions of the East, Buddhism, Hinduism, Islam, Shinto, and Confucianism, to which we are supposed to respond? In numerous ways, the non-Christian cultures of Asia and Africa have entered the stream of Western thought and action to a degree unparalleled at any time in the past. And the New Age is only one example. I know of no college or university in America that does not teach comparative religion. Courses in the religions of the world. And I've either read through, am familiar with, I would say, easily 20 of these textbooks. In every one, there was a search for a common denominator in which Christianity, and of course Catholicism, is just, well, another of the many religions of the world. And the net result is that Catholicism, for many Americans, is, well, just another religion. And when Hillary Clinton, for obvious political reasons, I'm sure you know that, made, shall I call it, a pilgrimage to Fatima. Did you know that?
Yes.
And Father Robert Fox, my dear friend, features Hillary Clinton in his magazine. In Rome we say, Mamma Mia. We better know, and I mean not just know about, but understand as much as with God's grace we can about the other religions, both, I repeat, because under Christ's command we are to share the fullness of God's truth, which God became man to teach the world, with those who do not have the fullness of truth in plain Catholic Anglo-Saxon to convert these people. But secondly, we need to know these other religions to protect our own faith. And I know what I'm talking about. The single deepest ambition of the United Nations is to create a new one world religion. Widely propagandized. Now the bottom of page 7. For those like us who believe they possess the fullness of God's revelation, to know about the religious systems of the world as a means of opening their horizon and animating their zeal to communicate what they have with others who are less privileged than they. Something like 2 years for the Archdiocese of Detroit to close 42 parishes. Chicago, same time, closing 62 parishes. All other reasons to the contrary notwithstanding, in my judgment, the main reason is a weakening, a darkening, and in wide circles, the loss of authentic Catholic faith by so many still professedly believing Catholics. Hear it. We are to understand, and I would say anything, for example, can you see this piece of chalk? can tell what color it is?
Yellow.
It is?
Yellow.
Yellow. What color is this?
White.
What color is this?
Black.
I should have pointed my casting, but... One of the basic norms of understanding anything is comparison, contrast, to distinguish yellow from white, yellow from green, yellow from orange. We're going to understand our Catholic faith. You better be able to distinguish. Am I making sense? Distinguish the Catholic religion from, say, Shinto. I've never heard about Shinto. And my friend, you better start hearing something. Otherwise, you'll be another one of the millions of Christians in America who have bought the New Age movement lock, stock, and barrel. The New Age movement is the Oriental religions imported into such countries as the United States. Hesitate, say, but I think I should. I am, I think, in passing, made references to Thomas Merton. As you know, if you've read his Seven Story Mountain, a convert to the Catholic faith, became a Catholic, then shortly after joined the Trappists. And he became very soon a prominent writer. Well, a book that I published, I think, in 72, Christianity, the 20th Century, a large section, many pages, on Thomas Merton. But then he died shortly after I began writing the book. Our deference to the dead removed all the pages on Thomas Merton. Thomas Merton became first attracted by and then bewitched by the mystics of the Orient. And I'm sure you know, where did Thomas Merton die?
India.
Yeah, near India.
Sri Lanka.
But,
no.
Well,
Burma.
Let's make it general. In Asia, attending an international congress on world religions. His first biographer, Thomas Merton, claimed that Merton died a Buddhist. I don't think so. I think he still held, and I want to think, the essentials of Christianity. There would be no New Age movement in the world today without Thomas Merton. My Jesuit superiors told me to work with both his abbot and with Thomas Merton, which I did. Things I will never publish, even talk about beyond the few words that I'm sharing with you. He was mesmerized, and I'm using a very mild verb, mesmerized by the Asiatic religions. Take a man like, oh, pardon me, how wonderful, how wonderful. Can you read it? With your blessings, my?
Matthew Fox.
Matthew Fox. Croatian spirituality. Our total borrowing from Asian religions. Widespread. Not just in America, other countries too. Creation, spirituality. You notice what I'm stressing, both to know what these religions have in common with our Catholic faith, and I have to use the verb to protect ourselves from being, and I have to say it, seduced. My people, whose religion may be very deep, very strong, in case of Hinduism, guess, 4,000 years old. Let's go on. Page 8. Some basic principles. Any approach to comparing the religions of the world assumes certain principles of judgment, at least as a norm for classification. But more important, to make sense of what is otherwise a maze of gods and goddesses, mythological fancies, and philosophical theories all strung together against the background of myriad details which the average Western mind has no context, almost no point of reference. I know what I am saying. Either we Catholics understand as much as we can, and watch it on Catholic premises, because in this you must believe, otherwise I would recommend you're not taking the course. You must believe that the Roman Catholic Church has the fullness of truth, and that Catholic Christianity is normative for all religions. Am I clear? That is why my first book on the Protestant Churches of America, widely read. And all I need to do is to catch up with the latest denominations, come out with a new edition. They keep changing so fast. As I know, the Protestants, they want a Catholic estimate. It's got to be authentically Catholic of their own religions. That's what I've said more than once. The Lutherans, the Baptists, the Anglicans paying the Jesuits good money to hire a Jesuit priest to teach them, can you imagine, Catholic Christianity. Are they out of their minds? No. You've got to love these people. Well, you must know your own faith and show them. Say, my dear Lutherans, you've got so much in common with the Catholic faith that Martin Luther abandoned on the first Halloween. And we now understand Halloween, October 31st, 1517. In other words, We will understand our own Catholic faith only, I keep repeating, by comparing it with. See the contrast between them and us. What they have, which we share, or what we have and they share, and where we differ, and where the difference is not merely semantic or verbal, but real. The first thing that strikes us as we delve into the living religions of mankind, and as I've said more than once, I've also taught over these years, I have taught the extinct religions, Roman religion, Greek religion, Egyptian, Babylonian, four principal religions that I've taught over the years, all pre-Christian, which have disappeared. But these are living religions. Is a fairly clear difference between what is properly their faith or creedal elements and the mythology that surrounds them. In other words, you don't just talk to an ordinary Muslim whom you happen to meet. And I've taught Islam, listen to this, through courses that I've taught from Chicago or Loyola University. I've taught about Islam to Muslims. Of course, as a Catholic, needless to say, and this is part of our training, most good dictionaries will define a Jesuit as shrewd, cunning, intriguing.
Yes. Yes.
So they're reading about Islam, but I make sure they learn all they can about Christianity. And they eat it up. They love it. In other words, there's so much mythology in these religions that is not really their religion. Having correctly pointed out that the mythological side of man's religion belongs to the poetical part of his nature, it is strangely forgotten in some quarters that a myth is the work of imagination and therefore a work of art. Unless these things are appreciated artistically, they're not appreciated at all, with the result that long dissertations are written and theories spun about the origin of myths, instead of seeing them as a spontaneous and exuberant expression for certain deep but often undefined beliefs of the true religious spirit of the people. That is where we, United States, we better wake up. I think I did tell you when I began the teleconferences on the angels and demons, had somebody do some research, find out how many books on the angels are currently in print in the United States and in English. And my God was 153. Remember the number of fish? Remember the apostles caught having fished all night, couldn't find anything. Our materialistic culture is sick and tired of our materialism. Am I making sense? Mm-hmm. Things you can touch, feel, taste, see, which we have in common with the animal world. You've got so much of this. We are the most fed nation in the world. You're also, and this is percentage-wise, the nation that has most people undergoing, what term shall I use, some form of psychotherapy. If there is one thing that we should know, and as we're beginning this course, by the way, read as much as you wish from the book that I've shared with you. We need to know that underlying every authentic religion is what? Is the spirit. Is that which we have in common, shall I use the expression, in common with God? In other words, by definition, a spirit is what cannot be perceived by the senses. So, does anyone speaking English have any doubt what we mean when we use the word nonsense? Say that again. Everyone who speaks English knows what we mean by the word nonsense. It's stupidity. It's unreal. As though the only real world were perceivable by the senses. Am I clear? I want to tell somebody that something is not important to me. For example, what time shall we have a meeting? And without a second thought, we say, it's immaterial to me. What do you mean, immaterial? It's not important. And talk about being a materialistic culture. We've even made a verb out of the noun matter. It does not matter to me. I just want to illustrate how profoundly materialistic our culture is. In every religion, by definition, with no exceptions, if it's a religion, believes in a world which is not perceptible by the senses. Starving Americans, and I mean that, starving for the truth, will latch on to anything to give them some relief from the materialistic society in which they live. The middle of page 9, paired with this inner religious core, more familiar inner structure of the main religious cultures as cogitated by the way. I think I've said this before. So I read some things that I published in my, well, less humble days, Hardin. Whatever possessed you to use the word as cogitated? You proud author. Pardon these words. The inner structure of the main religious cultures? Well, thought out by speculative philosophers. Most people outside of Christianity are not literate. Hear that. That needs to be known. Their own faith seldom appears in print, and for the most part is known only by and from those who have lived on intimate terms with this, call it a majority mind, of Afro-Asia. All the evidence points to their faith being religious in the fundamental sense of theistic. Even where a crude polytheism obscures the belief in a superior, in that sense supreme personal divinity. Now, and let's be careful, we must distinguish the hundreds, I want to say even thousands of millions of non-Christians who are not educated. As we speak of a sophisticated mind going through school, including, of course, college and the university. Thank God, most of the human race has not gone to college. Thank God. All the evidence points to their faith, as I said, being religious. In other words, they believe in something beyond and beneath the visible world that we can see and touch. Now the literati, the educated, whose written productivity has created the false impression that what they profess or doubt or deny is the common possession of most non-Christians. That's the most important statement. You never guess. Read books on whatever religion you want to study. Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, whatever. And most of the people, say, in China. Well, are of the Buddhist or Taoist persuasion, from what you read in books by specialists in these comparative religions. Now, and that is why Francis Xavier, when he went to India, sent by Ignatius, spent just 10 years in India. In 10 years, and at times, he was so dead tired baptizing, somebody had to hold his hands so he could pour water over the people. Over 100,000 people he baptized in his 10 years in India. But most of those were what we now call the outcasts. Hear it, philosophers, and I mean philosophers in Western countries like the United States, are atheistic, not because they necessarily oppose the idea of a personal God, but because they are indifferent to him as eternal lawgiver who must be obeyed. And therefore, and I thought this chapter should first be written before I got into these other religions. And what I got about these other religions, of course, I've got from printed sources. But most of my knowledge I got from those who had lived among these people, who knew these people, who loved them, and told them, no. For example, in extreme form, philosophic Buddhism denies the existence of God altogether and places exclusive emphasis on the deliverance of the immortal soul from the body. And in Detroit, I've seen I don't know how many places in Detroit where they teach some form of Buddhism. his attitude is conditioned by an unquestioned belief in reincarnation. And this, by the way, is the single deepest belief of the non-Christian world, especially in Asia, namely reincarnation, which it considers not as something desirable, but as the supreme evil. Human life, for the theorist of Buddhism, is not God's greatest gift to man, but a curse that inheres in the very nature of things. Tangible matter and the body are a perpetual drag on the soul, from which the soul longs to be freed. That is, in going through the streets of Calcutta for 5 weeks, during most of November and into December, thousands, millions, at least 1 million living on the streets, and thousands, as I've said more than once, sleeping on the sidewalks, streets of Calcutta. And they dare not try to rise above their present condition. Or others I've seen, matrons in bright silk saris, a dying body on the sidewalk. Hold on to something and step over the dead body. Never a thought. That's a human being. And this is why 24 years in teaching the missionaries of charity has taught me so much about the need for understanding our own faith more deeply, more clearly, more lovingly, by contrasting what, thank God, we know is the truth in comparison with the wild, incredible beliefs of those who do not share what we possess. Page 11. I say finally, by the 8th century prophets of Israel, the earlier monolatry became a true monotheism, and the dualism of the Avesta was cleared away. And we don't have that kind of time, but I'll share as much as I can with the time at our disposal. Only God knows how deeply, how profoundly Old Testament Judaism has influenced the whole world. And since the coming of Christ, how deeply Christianity has penetrated the whole world. As we'll see when we look at Shinto, whole sections of the Summa of St. Thomas just borrowed by Shinto. Isn't that neat? I think I've said on some occasion, and the Hindu especially, their principal and most popular Bible. Who knows? The Bhagavad Gita, sometimes simply called the Gita. Whole sections borrowed from St. John's Gospel. The human mind, and I mean this, is starving for the truth. And we have it. So on the one hand, the value of knowing what these religions of the human race have, which is true, and of course, we must believe that Christianity is normative for understanding any religion or any part of any religion. Jewish monotheistic universalism finds its clearest expression in the work of the Deutero-Isaiah, from which heritage of the Hebrew religion Christianity derived its pure monotheism, and the same influence is manifest in the religion of Islam, except the Muslims, as we'll see, tell their followers either convert those who believe that there are three persons in one God, and that the second person, oh no, the second person of God, of Allah, became a man and had a human mother. That, the Muslims are told, and here in Detroit, they're told that's idolatry. And these Christians, otherwise known in Muslim language as idolaters, should be either converted or put into slavery or hear it. Islam declares a martyr any Muslim who dies defending Islam, especially against Christianity. Let's go, last paragraph, page 11. Judeo-Christianity believes that historic religion is more than a natural phenomenon rising on its creedal side from animism through polytheism to the monotheism of the Hebrews and Christians. And by the way, one book in comparative religion after another's says exactly this. On his ritual side, from magic and fetishism, and that is what the sacraments of the Catholic Church are considered and written about in Walther's On Comparative Religion. Sacraments are the Catholic borrowing from magic. Aside from the curious fact that most contemporary religions are not purely monotheistic, which is hard to explain on the premise of a natural development of human culture. And I use the word Judeo-Christian because as Christians, we owe so much to Judaism, not just the Old Testament, but Jesus and Mary. In chronological order, Mary and Jesus. Before the end, on page 12, before the end of the second century, the Roman Celsus concentrated on the resurrection of Christ, which he recognized as pivotal in the new religion. The resurrection of Jesus, he said, should be equated with the stories of heroes in pagan mythology, with the story of Zamolxis, who dwelt beneath the earth for 3 years and returned to the surface of alive, of Ramesinaitis of Egypt, who played at dice with Demeter in Hades, he returned to the upper world with a golden napkin he received from her as a gift, or Orpheus among the Odrysians, Protesilaus in Thessaly, Hercules at Cape Tyrannus, and Theseus and other life fables. And when now we have Catholic theologians speaking about Christ's resurrection as well, not necessarily historical. All I can tell you is that Christianity is not only the one true religion. And I've told my students over the years, especially in teaching comparative religion to many non-Catholics, Catholic Christianity is thoroughly provable by reason and history alone. Jesus did really die. He physically rose from the dead, and he is physically present in the Holy Eucharist. And all I can tell you is, and the more clearly and deeply we understand other religions, provided we know our own religion well, the more clearly and deeply we will strive to the limits of our power, pardon me, beyond the limits of our power. That's what grace is all about. Doing things which are humanly impossible to bring those who don't have the fullness of truth, because we have it. And what the world desperately needs is the fullness of the truth. Other religions do have, in greater or less measure, some truth. Oh, how much I would want to share with you. Our faith, I repeat, is provable by reason, knowable by history, and therefore livable rationally. And the more clearly and deeply you know these other religions, the more, I mean it, you'll appreciate your own faith. But also want to share what God has so generously, shall I add, unworthily given to us. Suppose I start some questions. If God was a single person and not a plurality of persons, could love still exist? No. How is love related to the Trinity? Well, we haven't had a course on the Trinity yet. First of all, the answer to the first question is an emphatic no. By the way, don't hesitate passing it around.
Oh, do you want a basket to put them in?
No, I'll hold this.
They're right here.
Pass that around.
Oh, you want me to pass? Still pass it around.
First of all, God cannot be a single person. There cannot be a God who is not three persons. To question that God must be three persons is to deny his existence. And in teaching the Trinity, oh, the hours I will spend explaining my Jesuit students, there must be a plurality in existence, beginning with God. And that's why there cannot be love. In other words, the only hypothesis would be that nothing exists. How is love related to the Trinity? Well, love is related to the Trinity in three ways. Would have to be in three ways. First of all, that's what love is. Another name for God is love. Another name for God is Trinity. She was not. How is love related to the Trinity? The Trinity is love. That is God. Secondly, love within the Trinity is the total sharing of the one divine nature by the three persons with, shall we say, one another. Love means sharing. Love means giving what you've got. That's why we have anything. Do you hear me? Whatever we have, we are meant to share. Father, will you please say more? Well, put a period after that sentence. And the more we have, the more we are divinely obliged to share. So, love is related to the Trinity because that's what God is, the three persons sharing with one another. However, God is not only love. God is loving, at least in my vocabulary, and that's borrowed from the Latin. Deus est amor, God is love. But Deus est amans, God is loving. That's why we're here. And except for God's almighty love, nothing except God would exist. And God cannot not exist. There must be God. But God, in his, I repeat, either loving omnipotence or almighty love, chose, thanks Lord, thanks for sharing what he as God has without losing anything in the process with the creatures, that's us, whom he chose to put into existence. And no two creatures, from the smallest flea to the Himalaya mountains, no two creatures are alike. Do you hear me? No two are the same. Scientists tell us not even two snowflakes are identical. And God, therefore, and is, I repeat, omnipotent love, chose to bring creatures into existence with whom he shares something of what he has. And among these creatures, he created two, the angels and human beings, with a free will. Everything these creatures have, everything they have, comes from God. Everything. Well, there is one possession they have, that the angels and we, which can choose, talk about mystery. Either to, well, share with God what he's given to us by sharing with others, or we won't reach our destiny. That's why, hear it, we all need needy people in our lives. And the more needy, the better. We need them. Because by meeting their needs, we earn our destiny. Pardon me. What religion or religions are the Kurds and Turkish people in Turkey? Mainly the Muslim. Do you think churches will be closed in downtown Detroit soon? Well, I don't know, first of all, how many more will be closed, and whether those in downtown Detroit will be closed soon. Whatever you can do from keeping them open, do so. Keep the churches open. Of course, somebody must go to these churches. Somebody, of course, must support them. And this is where our course on the priesthood is so crucial. There is nothing America more needs, nothing, than priestly priests. Nothing. To provide us with the two sacraments of the Eucharist and confession. Last evening we had a discussion on Columbus forcing the Christian religion on the Indians. Is there a good book to read on Columbus? Yes, there is. First, I would recommend, pardon me for saying this, reading, I think they're all in print, my 6 lectures that I gave during 1992. And when we meet in February, I have several good books. In fact, I'll bring them with me. Because we're waiting on Columbus and lecturing, I had to buy the books. For those about forcing the Christian religion, Lord, have mercy on us. Would you encourage a young man for the priesthood when there is so much opposition towards certain young men on a diocesan level? Oh, sure. One of my favorite apostolates is promote vocations to the priesthood. But you better know what you're doing. First of all, know your own faith. And then I tell young men who are interested in the priesthood, be sure you go to a good seminary. You be taught, well, the truth. In fact, we need courageous, strong, not just in muscle, strong in mind, clever, pardon me, intriguing, shrewd priests. Why did Hillary Clinton go to Fatima? She would be a smart ass, I think she is. She did not want to, well. Convince Catholics. Sure, I am pro-abortion. Sure, I am, well, for contraception. Sure, I want the United Nations to establish a one-world religion. But Hillary is a very intelligent woman. My friends in Washington tell me, for the first time in our history, we have a woman president. Did the Holy Father recently uplift the excommunication of Martin Luther? If so, why not Archbishop Lefebvre, leader of the Society of Pope Pius X? Well, no. Holy Father had not lift the excommunication from Martin Luther. He didn't. Martin Luther stands as excommunicated as he was by the Pope's predecessor, Pope Leo XIII. Pope Leo X, Pope Leo X, date 1520. Why are the bishops promoting sex education in our schools in Russia? It is forbidden because the Russians believe that it only arouses the passions and corrupts the youth. What is behind our church promotion of sex education? Well, those who want to mislead American youth from the basic Christian principles of chastity. And sadly, so many dioceses have not just permitted, but even mandated sex education. Did you tell a priest Did you tell us, a priest, only need to intend to consecrate, and this is not necessarily whether he believes, how are belief and intent connected? Well, I'm just quoting the church's teaching that faith or lack of it in a validly ordained priest, faith does not determine a valid consecration. Faith or lack of it. Am I clear? The church teaches a priest who has lost his Catholic faith or abandoned it can nevertheless offer a valid mass and give valid absolution. But the intention, which is in the will, he must want his want to at least do what the people who are attending the Mass expect him to do. Or a person coming to confession wants to be absolved. Now, the relationship between unbelief, or let's make it belief, and intent is very close. In other words, most people, I would say most sane people, intend to do what they believe. And consequently, there is no way that we can tell whether a priest who does no longer believe in the real presence is offering a valid mass, because we don't really know whether he intended to offer Mass, even though he no longer believes in it. The odds are that the Mass is not valid. Am I clear? However, I repeat the Church's teaching. Unbelief as such does not invalidate the administration of the sacraments, especially the Eucharist and confession. What was the Jewish concept of heaven or the afterlife before Christ? Were their understanding of God's promises and prophecies limited to fulfillment on earth in this life? No! However, long before the time of Christ, there were both believing Jews and unbelieving Jews. Jews who believed were the prophets Isaiah, Jeremiah, and the others taught. And the unbelieving Jews, like who? Like the scribes and Pharisees. And now there were believing Jews. My heavens, Our Lady was a believing Jewess. Elizabeth was a believing Jewess. John the Baptist was a believing Jew. And what happened? We know what happened. When the Messiah came, the leaders of the people were the unbelieving Jews. Am I clear? All they had to do was read Isaiah, Jeremiah, and the other prophets. Everything which Christ taught the prophets, he already indicated he would teach. And then those who were not believing Jews were those then who crucified Jesus. And for 300 years, behind the persecution of the Jews in the Roman Empire, were the unbelieving Jews. And I have, over the years, lectured in Jewish synagogues. And nobody threw anything at me. Even paid the Jesuits good money for my honorarium. I love the Jewish people because we've got to convert the Jewish people. We overdue. Work on them. Pardon me. Do you perceive among American bishops a return to fidelity to the Pope? Well, I should, with all my heart, hope and pray that those American bishops who are estranged from the Bishop of Rome will return to loyalty to the Vicar of Christ. What is the difference between Muslim and Muslim? The Muslims prefer being called Muslims. Those who don't know much about Islam call them Muslims. So, Muslim is the word which they prefer. Catholic theology teaches that the bishops have the fullness of the priesthood and must obey. But a bishop is advocating dissent. Do we have to obey him or them? As I'm sure I've said before, thanks for raising the question. The answer is, a bishop is to be, first of all, accepted his teaching. In other words, his teaching is to be accepted. And His orders are to be obeyed only when and insofar as both his teaching and his orders conform to the teaching and the orders of the Bishop of Rome, period. How's that? Well, the great gifts of the Second Vatican Council. Gee, thanks for the questions. When you speak of the Detroit Arabic community belonging to Islam, do you compensate for the large communities of Chaldeans? Then we have Iraqi Catholics, Lebanese Catholics, and Palestinian or Jordanian Orthodox Christians. Well, no. I'm not speaking of Arabs. I'm speaking of Muslims. The largest concentration and the most, I would say, most zealous form of Islam in the United States is in Detroit. And of course, I know communities of Chaldeans, Lebanese Catholics, Palestinian or Jordanian Orthodox Christians. Thank God. As we see in German, wunderbar, wonderful. I'm speaking of Muslims as Muslims. Their concentration is very large in Detroit, and you know why. Because, as they've done in Africa, to concentrate on the Africans, and here, the Afro-Americans. And they've done Islamic wonders in organizing both Islamic Africans in Africa and organizing Islamic Afro-Americans. Am I clear? In other words, providing the African people with a religious unity. Am I still clear? And sadly, oh, how sadly, we Christians have not done that which Christ wants us to do. I did tell you, didn't I? Now, the most extraordinary growth in the church in her 2,000 years of history has it was happened in Africa. Remember? From less than 500,000 Catholics in all of Africa in 1900, our latest figure was 1990, 74 million Roman Catholics. And mainly brought to the Catholic faith by lay, zealous Catholic missionaries. And that's what we need in America. My dear fellow Americans, let's start evangelizing America. Who would believe that America needs to be converted? Do you believe that? And this same Africa has had millions of martyrs. I think I've told you this more than once. Sudan alone, over 2 million in the 1950s of our century. And having taught comparative religion to missionaries, well, on furlough, you might say, to get a degree in missiology. They told me to become a Christian in some parts of Africa means expecting martyrdom. I have to say it. What cowards we Catholics can be. How comfortable. How sweet. Our faith If it is the goal of the United Nations to form a one world religion, or the driving force behind such an endeavor, well, what else? There's no way you can really, really unite people except by having them share the same faith. Or by uniting even two people in marriage. The German hierarchy, that's some years ago, told their fellow, well, Catholics, please be careful about entering into a mixed marriage. You know what I mean. One person is a Catholic, the other is not a Catholic. Because, I'm quoting the German bishops, we can prove by the third generation of all mixed marriages, most of the children are lost to the Catholic faith. And a husband and wife are to be deepening in love with one another. And we are spiritual beings. There is nothing which unites two human beings more closely than sharing the same faith. So, in other words, that's behind this endeavor. How do you explain the miracles that happen to people of different religions? Recovery from physical illnesses. Miraculous intervention in time of life threatening circumstances. Financial recuperation. Well, again, very happy to teach a course on miracles, which I taught for years. One of my unpublished books, as I told you, is on miracles. First of all, you must distinguish between what is a miracle and what is a prodigy. Both miracles and prodigies are beyond the human ability to perform. Now, notice I'm putting aside the so-called, say, wonders performed, say, in Christian Science. Or, well, the wonders, the unusual occurrences performed by people who are clever. But putting all of that aside, if it is something which exceeds the powers of nature, there are two forces at work in the world. And they are the good spirit and the evil spirit. And the good spirit, obviously, is behind what is an authentic miracle. Evil spirit is behind everything which we call in English, because of the Latin, a prodigy. And therefore, either what we call, notice call, a miracle, in quotation marks. Maybe just something astounding, wonderful, that is performed by nature. Or secondly, It is something extraordinary performed by the evil spirit. And thirdly, it was performed by God, either directly or through those who are united with him, have been gifted with what we call miraculous powers. One of the hardest things to prove is an authentic miracle, especially when other powers may be at work. How many of you ever heard about Josefa Menendez? Ever share this with you? About Josefa? I tell you about that? While doing my graduate studies in Rome, one of my confreres worked for the Congregation for the Causes of Saints. He told me that Josefa Menendez's case has been dropped by the Holy See. She will never be beatified or canonized. And as my informant told me, she may have been very holy. But there are so many humanly indescribable occurrences in her life that there is no way we can find out whether they were prodigies or miracles. She'd been missing for breakfast, as a visitation none. So then, the superior would send two sisters to look for Sister Josefa. Nowhere in sight. Then, they would walk about 100 yards from the monastery, where, by the way, I was in conversation with the same superior that Josefa had. And she said, "Father," he would walk away from the monastery. And there was poor Sister Josefa holding onto the chimney at the roof of a monastery. No way, humanly speaking, could have got there. Now she had to get down. Well, and over the years, how many call the mystics, at least so they thought they were, have entered my life. If we are to know other religions in order to convert, is it recommended that we read the Quran in order to communicate with the large Muslim population? Ever Detroit? I would say no. Why not? And by the way, I have had to obviously read the Quran. Because Muhammad was a genius. Only God knows. I know I'm being taped in saying this. But the phenomenal success of Islam over the centuries is not due to mere human genius. Muhammad, I think I should say it, and Islam has been so prodigiously successful because of a spiritual power that is not from God. I met a Protestant minister in a crowd as I distributed pro-life material. He told me he disagreed. "I'm afraid I did not respond in the best way. What should I have said?" Well, it's one thing for a person to say, "I disagree." So I would ask him, "Do you believe that human life is immortal. Our souls are immortal. Secondly, when does a human being begin to exist? Two questions. And the great likelihood would be he would tell you, who's intelligent, say, I don't believe there's a human being until that non-human being is born. So, people disagree with what we believe. They have their own premises. You have your pastor's minister. You might also have belief, or asked him whether you believe that Jesus Christ is God. Because I can tell you, not all pastor's ministers believe in Christ's divinity, including Martin Luther. Do you hear me? Including Martin Luther. Some of his unpublished books, what he has Christ doing, no one in his right mind would dare attribute to Jesus Christ. Manuscripts of Martin Luther, they will never be published. May Lutherans or any other non-Catholic group receive Holy Communion at Mass. No. Does the priest or the bishop have the authority to allow this practice, for example, a wedding? No. That's spelled N-O, and it's followed by an apostrophe, an exclamation mark. No, exclamation mark. What books would you recommend for an adult interested in converting to Catholicism, which you have written? Well, I have, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4 catechisms. Any one of them I would recommend. The Catholic Catechism, the Pocket Catholic Catechism, the Question and Answer Catholic Catechism, and it's called The Faith, published by Servant Publications, which is a catechism of the Catechism of the Catholic Church, which is a tool by Rome to put together. Some 1,300 questions based on the Catechism of the Catholic Church. But Doubleday wrote to Servant Publications, if you call that a question and answer Catechism of the Catholic Church, we will sue you. So, Student Publications changed the title, just plain Faith. A recent television special on the Kennedy White House portrayed a very dark picture of his personal life. The focus of the program was his ongoing involvement with various women to the point that national security was at stake. As our first Catholic president, we were proud of him. What should we think now? Pray for him. Pray for Kennedy. For the repose of his soul, of course. I am troubled with a new order of Mass with a priest facing the people because of the time of consecration. Most, but not all, priests focus on the people and not the host. Can you comment? Well, there is no document of the Second Vatican Council which either orders or even recommends saying Mass facing the people. And this is where, if I had asked you to pray for the repose of the soul of Kennedy, I would ask you to pray for the conversion of many of our liturgists. We're behind so much what is going on in the Catholic liturgy today. A priest, my Lord, when he offers Mass, should concentrate on the bread that he's consecrating to become the body of Christ. How do we establish a relationship with the Holy Spirit this year, 98? How do we get to know him? First, I recommend that you get a copy. I hope the book is in print. If it's not, borrow a copy. The best book on the Holy Spirit that I know is entitled The Holy Ghost. Oh no. Yes, it's Holy Ghost. And the author is Edward Lean. Edward Lean, L-E-E-N. A masterpiece. He died prematurely over the years, and long before my ordination, he deeply shaped my life. So Edward Lean's book on the Holy Ghost. Secondly, and get a copy of the book, or have somebody Xerox a copy, or do something. It's a masterpiece. Secondly, understand what the Holy Ghost gives us. And he gives us three precious things. The Holy Ghost gives us the virtues, which means the powers that we possess. The virtues of faith, hope, and charity, and the virtues of prudence, justice, fortitude, and temperance. Those are powers. Secondly, the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Who knows how many there are?
Fruits.
How many?
Seven gifts of all fruits.
Well, first, pardon me, there are seven gifts of the Holy Spirit. First thing, Holy Spirit will be, not happy. You think he gave us only five gifts, seven, okay? Seven gifts of the Holy Spirit, and know them. And I've divided the week into the seven gifts of the Holy Spirit. Sunday, the gift of wisdom. Monday, the gift of understanding. Tuesday, the gift of knowledge. Wednesday, the gift of
counsel.
Wednesday, the gift of
counsel.
Let's see once more. Wisdom, understanding, knowledge, and counsel. S-E-L, counsel. Then Thursday, the gift of fortitude, Friday, the gift of piety, and Saturday, the gift of the fear of the Lord. Then, the 12 fruits of the Holy Spirit. Time is running out. The 12 fruits. What are the virtues? The virtues are the powers. Powers to perform those seven virtues. What are the gifts? The gifts are the inclinations, the urges that we get, called gifts, to practice the seven virtues. And the fruits are the 12 joys. Our English word fruit comes from the Latin frui, which means to enjoy. So the 12 fruits of the Holy Spirit, the 12 joys that we are to experience in doing, God's will. And I would say there's no better way of practicing devotion to the Holy Spirit that find out, first of all, among those seven virtues, which virtue do you most need to develop? Faith, hope, charity, prudence, justice, fortitude, and temperance. And we'll work on the virtue that you need for at least a week. And then next week, work on another virtue. That's the way I was trained. Would you recommend John Chapin's book, published 1956, on Catholic quotations? 1956, Catholic quotations. Is it John? Is that the author? And is it, the question, you know, is it a fairly thick book?
Yes.
Is it bound?
Yes.
Bound in like, yes, like a purple cover?
Yes.
Yes.
Is it?
Yes.
Yes, yes. Highly recommend it. I use it constantly. How can I learn to think before I speak? Oh. You know what I forgot? And on Christmas, I don't usually send out Christmas cards. When people send me greetings, then I feel I should acknowledge them. So I have drafted, first of all, a letter thanking the people for sending their Christmas greetings. And then I try to include at least a short manuscript to the people whom I to write, say, after Christmas. And this year I'm sending out a lecture that I gave on writing and a spiritual life. How do I learn to think before I speak? Answer, write. That's spelled W-R-I-T-E and two exclamation marks. Write. Most people can talk without thinking. I've watched them. You cannot write without thinking. You can scribble, you can scrawl, but you cannot write. Write. And the Holy Spirit inspired both the Old and New Testament to be put into written form. And most of the human race was, as we say, illiterate. Holy Spirit thinks writing is important. We better think so too. Thanks. How do we dispose of old metals, old scapulars, and rancid old blessed oil? Well, my gosh. Pardon me, what's wrong with wearing an old medal? Pardon me. Now, of course, if the medal can no longer be worn because, well, what do you call that?
Dust.
The hook on the medal, whatever you call that, see? So, well, they should be one of two things. Now, it's pretty hard to burn metals, but bury them in the ground away from where people walk. That's my normal recommendation. Bury sacred objects, sacramentals, and so on. Then pour the oil on the ground, I repeat, where people do not walk. Are you familiar with Bishop Burnett of Seattle? Recently appointed, is he in agreement with Rome or with the American Church? I must say, he's too new for me to know him. Otherwise, I would honestly tell you, I don't know. Do most primitive religions have some type of exorcism ritual. Well, they don't call it exorcism. Yes. In other words, we call it primitive people. Well, they're not too primitive because there are hundreds of millions in the world today. What we call exorcism, for them, it is either placating or somehow pleasing the evil deities. And this is where, from pre-Christian times, I repeat, up to here it, up to the time when Great Britain took over India, the polytheists in India had infant sacrifices to the malevolent deities. One of the first things that Great Britain did was to forbid those human sacrifices. And that's not too long ago. So yes, they don't call it exorcism because being believers in many gods, there is no non-Christian religion that's polytheistic in history. None. Either ancient or modern, which does not believe in both good and evil deities. Am I clear? They all believe in both good and evil deities, and they are deities. Now for us Christians, we believe that the so-called evil deities are not deities at all. They are evil spirits. So they do not exorcise in our sense of drive out, but they placate, they propitiate, all kinds of things which they do to these evil deities to protect both themselves, their children, their families, because unless those evil deities are placated, then they will suffer. This I'm told, I've been told over the years by my students, especially in Canada. Missionaries from foreign countries, one of the main reasons for not being as successful in converting some of these people into Christianity or Catholicism is because of the danger, the threats to which they are exposed if they convert. If God equals love, is he more than that? Does he love the fallen angels and those who die in mortal sin, as well as the righteous? Yes. Oh, well, at least a good semester course we can take in the meaning, the theology of love. You parents with children, you don't need to put up your hand. All you have to do is smile. Have you ever inflicted at least some slight pain on the children whom you deeply loved? Have you?
Yes.
Does his hatred of evil and his request of us to hate evil come from love? Yes. Is hatred or exclusion from heaven love? Yes. Doesn't God love his enemies? Yes. But what a question which deserves an unusual answer.